السلام عليكم. Today we will start our lecture. Unfortunately, without our boss, Dr. Mahmoud, he has a busy on call. So we wish he will join us soon. Today we will start by the rapid reporting part on the chest plain radiograph. So we will start now. About the introduction, again, we are repeatedly saying that you are a radiologist. You should take all the all the information from the radiograph, not only the obvious one. You should search for the causes and complications of every finding, and you should train your eye very well to catch the abnormality fast. And to catch any hidden abnormality also, you should train yourself about the checklist. You should develop it again and again. Our content today, we'll talk about the normal anatomy of the chest radiograph in the AP and lateral views, or in the frontal and the lateral views, and the abnormalities that could happen. I tried to make it simple in 6 points: air in the lung or outside the lung, the hilum and the mediastinum, the cardiac part, bones, soft tissues, and at last the lines and the tubes. Our friend today will be the air. The air inside the lung could have any changes like opacities or masses or cystic changes or interstitial lung disease. The air outside the lung could be in the pleura or in the mediastinum or in the pneumoperitoneum, like we talked in the last week in the abdomen. We will start by the normal anatomy. This is the PA and the lateral views of the chest radiograph. First thing, this is the visualized parts of the loops of the lung. The right lung has 3 loops: the upper and the middle and the lower. And the left lung only has 2 loops: the left upper and left lower. This is imaginary lines. First, you should start by the patient and image data seen on the upper left corner of the image, like written here. This is the left side, this is the AB projection, this is the supine image, or other data for the patient. The importance of this part is to detect any changes in the situs. Like here, this is the marker of the right side, and you can see the cardiac apex here is pointing to the right side. Also, the stomach air bubble is on the right side. So this is a dextrocardia with situs inversus. Sometimes the film could be inverted. See here, the marker is left, but in your right hand. So take care from this. Any dextrocardia you suspect, you should first see, look for any previous radiographs for this patient to make sure that this is a real dextrocardia. And you can ask also for clinical correlation from the referring physician. The other thing you should see, look for, the rotation and penetration and inspiration. We will talk on each part. Here is the rotation. How can we detect? See, the medial ends of the clavicles should be at the same distance from the spinous processes of the thoracic vertebrae. Here is the same distance, but see on this, there is a rotation to the right side. Here another example, a rotation to the left side here. And see for the changes you could see on the left lung from this rotation. The left CP angle is not so clear, right, like the right one. Another one for the rotation. here is rotated to the right side. See, you can suspect here there is a soft tissue density or any abnormality, but the problem is in the rotation. The second thing is for inspiration, you should count anterior 6 reps till the diaphragm or posterior 10 reps till the diaphragm. Here is the posterior one. You should train yourself how to count the reps. Here in expiratory film, you can see only 3 or 4 reps till the diaphragm. And also you can detect the changes due to this expiratory film, that you can suspect here consolidation or suspect any mediastinal changes. So take care from this. This is another example for inadequate inspiration. Here you can see only 4 to 5 reps in the anterior reps till the diaphragm. You can suspect here cardiomegaly or suspect any opacification on the left lung, but all these changes are due to the inadequate inspiration. Again, another example here, you can suspect here cardiomegaly slightly or pulmonary edema. There is reticular changes here, perihilar, but all of these are due to poor inspiration or inadequate inspiration. This is an example for good inspiration and poor one. See, the changes are so clear. In the good inspiration film, you can see the dome of diaphragm are tensing. And if you take a horizontal line from the medial to lateral part, it should have 1 centimeter from the center point of the diaphragm. Here, lost in the hyperexpansion in COPD patients, the diaphragm become flat. The third thing you should look for is the penetration. The middle image is the ideal one, adequate penetration. You can see the ribs, you can see the underlying lung, you can see the borders of the mediastinum. Here, over penetration, the ribs are not so clear, and under penetration, everything is soft. Another example for under penetration here on the right side, and here good penetration on the left side. You can see the medial parts of the diaphragm and paraspinal lines and the cardiac shadow and the retrocardiac areas. In plain radiograph, to say upper zone or middle zone or lower zone, because you cannot detect the fissures sharply, so better to be broad. Here is the area of the horizontal fissure on the right lung. Here on the lateral image, the area of the left and the right oblique fissures. Here is a normal variant named azygos fissure, making azygos loop. Don't confuse it with any abnormality. Here is the area of the aortic knuckle. You should train your eye about the soft tissue density of the aortic knuckle and its shape like that, smooth. And this is the descending aorta here. Here is what we called a aorto-pulmonary window. This is the aortic knuckle and this is the pulmonary left pulmonary artery. Between them, there is a clear area here. Sometimes if there is enlarged lymph nodes due to any cause, you cannot see this clear area. It will be soft tissue like that. Again, this is the normal aortopulmonary window. See here in the star, but see on the left image, this is the aortic knuckle and this is the left pulmonary artery and lost clear space. It is occupied by a soft tissue density here. Now we will talk about the trachea and carina. The trachea should be central on the spinous processes of the thoracic vertebrae, and there is a paratracheal clear space here. It should not be more than 5 millimeters, and the carina angle should be acute. If there is any abnormality here, could make it obtuse angle. So you should train your eye about this angle. This is example for the right paratracheal stripe. Here should not exceed 5 millimeters. This is the normal hilar position, the right hilar here, and this is the left hilar is more superior to the right hilar, and this is what we called the hilar point. You should train also your eye about this. Again, this is a closed view, close-up view for the hilar. This is the right one, and this is the left one. This is the hilar point here, and this is the hilar point here. Should train your eye very well for this, for the density and for its shape. Again, this is the pulmonary arteries here, the inferior pulmonary arteries also are very important part for of the hilar. Another thing you should train your eye on, the soft tissue density on the plain radiograph. Now we will start by the abnormalities. First, we will talk about the air inside the lung and air outside the lung. First, we will talk about the opacities. We should have some concepts that we will apply in each film we see in our life or in the exams. The concepts we will talk about: the silhouette sign, air bronchogram, cervicothoracic sign, hilum overlay sign, thoracoabdominal sign, spine black sign, and little finger sign. First, we'll talk about the silhouette sign. Silhouette sign, normally if there is air and soft tissue density beside each other, you should see a line between them. If this line is lost, so the air become a soft tissue density also. This is an important clue for the abnormalities in the lung. We have eight lines we should search for. The first one here on the left cardiac border, this is with lingula, part of the left upper lobe, and both diaphragm, left hemidiaphragm and right hemidiaphragm, in contact with the lower lobes, left and right lower lobes. Another line here we talked about is the paratracheal line. This is with the trachea and the right upper lobe. And there is also a line between the lung and the chest wall, the pleura and the rib. Another lines we should know: the right cardiac border here. This is with the right middle lobe. Also, there is a paraspinal line here, right and left paraspinal. This is in contact with the lower lobes also, posterior part of them. There is a line between the aortic knuckle and the left upper lobe, and the horizontal fissure here on the right side also with the right upper lobe. So we can locate the abnormalities according to this line. If the left heart border is not seen, so there is abnormality in the lingula. Right heart border is with the right middle lobe, left hemidiaphragm, left lower lobe, right hemidiaphragm, right lower lobe. The aortic knuckle is with left upper lobe or the middle mediastinum. Descending aorta is with the left lower lobe or posterior mediastinum. The right paratracheal is with the right upper lobe or anterior mediastinum, and paraspinal lines with the posterior mediastinum or medial parts of the lungs. The second concept we should know is called air bronchogram. When the alveoli is filled with fluid due to pus, due to hemorrhage, due to heart failure, the bronchi and bronchioles still have air. So you can see there is alveolar opacification here, and the bronchioles and the bronchi has still air, making what is called air bronchogram sign. This is lost if the opacification is due to a mass lesion, not due to consolidation. So it is an important sign should look for in every opacification. Here also another example for air bronchogram. Another one here, you can see it. The third sign is named cervicothoracic sign. This occurs when there is a upper lung zone mass, as you see here. If the lateral border of the mass is sharp above the clavicle, so you can locate this mass in the posterior mediastinum. and if the the lateral border of the mass is fades away above the clavicle, so it is in the anterior mediastinum. So this is important sign also you should know. This is example for this. There is a mass here in the right upper lung zone, and the lateral border is seen sharp above the clavicle here, so it is a posterior mediastinal mass. You can also see if there is, if it is clear on your screen, you can see the second rib posteriorly, there is rib destruction. The third sign we will talk about is the hilum overlay sign. That's when a mass occur in the area of the hilum. You should locate it anterior to the hilum, or at the hilum itself, or posterior to the hilum. If it occur in the anterior, anterior or posterior to the hilum, it will you can see the hilum very clearly, and this is the sign that we call the hilum overlay sign. You can see here the right main bronchus and the branching bronchi, and you can see beside it the inferior pulmonary artery, right side, and the upper and lower one. Another example for it, there is a mass here, but if you zoom, you can see here the density for the hilar vessels. So this mass is not at the hilum, it is anterior to it or posterior to it. Another example for it, you can see here the inferior pulmonary vessel very clearly, and here you can see the upper pulmonary vessel very clearly also. Again, there is another example for the hilar. Visual, you can see the hilar vessels and hilar point. Other sign named thoracoabdominal sign, it is not so important. It occurs when there is a posterior mediastinal mass disturbing the paraspinal lines on each side of the vertebrae. It can continue to the abdomen like that, or only in the intrathoracic area, and it has a wide differential diagnosis like extramedullar hematopoiesis or paraspinal abscesses, or if there is trauma and fractures, it could be a hematoma. Here is example for it on the right side, and here on both right and left sides. Another important sign only on the lateral view you can see, named spine black sign, that on the thoracic vertebral bodies, if you go down, the vertebral bodies appear more black. If it is not more black, so suspect opacification of this part of the lung. Like here, this is the normal one, and there is abnormality here. If you go down, there is opacification here. The vertebral bodies appear more dense, not more black. The last sign is the little finger sign. This is for the inferior pulmonary vessels on the right and the left side. It should be clear like that. Here you can see the right side and the left side. If it is lost, so you can you should suspect abnormalities in the lower lobes of the lung. Here again, you can see this is the right side and this is the left side. We will start by the right upper loop. You should know the difference between the consolidation and the collapse. The consolidation only alveolar opacification with air bronchograms. There is no volume loss, no mediastinal shift, no hilar shift. Like here, this example is for right upper loop consolidation, and this is the horizontal fissure is seen clearly. If there is signs of collapse, you should know that the horizontal fissure moves superiorly like that, making a golden S sign. The right hilum is elevated and the collapsed lobe is dense. This is the right upper loop dense. Okay. The golden S sign also refer to that there is a mass or a tumor causing this collapse. Here is an example for it. This is the golden S sign here. There is a mass here, and there is the right hilar is elevated upward. Another example for the right upper lobe collapse. You can see the trachea is shifted to the ipsilateral side. The right middle lobe collapse is in contact with the right heart border. You can see this is the triangular opacity. The right heart border is not so clear like the left heart border. It is lost, so there is a consolidation in the right middle lobe. This is another example. This is the right heart border not clearly seen, but you can see the right hemidiaphragm, so the right lower lobe is okay. This is the signs of right middle lobe collapse. Loss of the right heart border. There is a in the lateral radiograph, you can see a triangular opacity like that, seen retrocardiac. Here the right hilar position is not altered, like what happened in the right upper or right lower loop. This is the right middle lobe collapse. The right heart border not so clear here. There is triangular density in the cardiac shadow. Should train your eye very well. There is mimickers for the right middle lobe collapse. Here you cannot see the right heart border also, so you will suspect a right middle lobe collapse, but the patient has no signs of infection, no signs of tumors. So there is a benign cause behind this finding, that there is a pectus excavatum. You can see the horizontal posterior ribs and anterior ribs are steven shaped. If you find one like that, you should examine the patient clinically, or if there is any previous imaging, lateral radiograph or any previous CT, you should look for. Here see the sternum is depressed. Another mimicker for the right middle lobe collapse. There is a mass here in the right hilum. The right heart border you cannot see very well, but it is in contact with the right heart border, this mass. So you should suspect here a differential diagnosis. The first one of them is a pericardial cyst. Another one here, there is opacification on the right middle and lower lung zones. The right heart border you cannot see very well, and the right hemidiaphragm also you cannot see. But if you see look here, there is a meniscus sign of pleural effusion. So, and there is air bronchogram here. So you suspect right middle lobe consolidation or pneumonia with underlying pleural effusion. Another mimicker for the right middle lobe collapse, that there is bilateral perihilar consolidation with minute cystic changes here, no lymph node enlargement or pleural effusion, and this patient should be immune compromised. This named a pneumocystitis pneumonia. Now we will talk about the right lower lobe. See here, this is consolidation of the right lower lobe. There is parts of the right hemidiaphragm not seen very well, but the right heart borders, you can see it very well, so the right middle lobe is okay. Another example for the opacification of the right lower lobe, but associated with rib fractures, so we will call it a contusion, lung contusion. The alveoli filled by blood, not pus or fluid. Here, this is signs of the right lower lobe collapse. It will be a triangular opacity on the right lower lung zone. The right hilum should be pulled down. And as we said on the little finger sign, the right inferior pulmonary vessel you should not see clearly. And the spine black sign also we say it before. Here is the example for the right lower lobe collapse. There is a triangular opacity here, the right hemidiaphragm medial end, you cannot see very clear, and you can see the right hyla is pulled down. See, this is the normal example for the little finger sign. It is lost here. It is more evident here, the right lower lobe collapse, that there is a triangular opacity and the medial part of the right hemidiaphragm not seen very well, and the right lower lobe pulmonary artery not seen also. Here in this image, you can see the right heart border not completely seen, and the right hemidiaphragm also not completely seen. So this is a right middle and right lower lobe collapse due to obstruction of the right bronchus intermedius. Here is a mimicker, a great mimicker for the right lower lobe opacification named epicardial fat. You can see the density of this part is grayish, not white like the density of the collapse. Here also the density here is for fat. So don't confuse with the right lower lobe collapse. Train your eye on it. Now we will talk about the left upper lobe. This is the left upper lobe consolidation. There is air bronchograms here, and there is no signs of the collapse. Signs of the collapse of the left upper lobe. The first one is called a veil-like density, that the whole right, the whole left upper lobe is white or more dense, less black. The left heart border is not seen, and the aortic knuckle surrounded by air lucency due to the hypertranslucency of the left lower lobe. This sign named Loft Sickle sign. It is a very important sign for the left upper lobe collapse. Here is the example for left upper lobe collapse. You can see the aortic knuckle surrounded by a halo of or lucent line of air due to the hyperlucent left lower lobe. You can see here the veil-like opacity. This is the normal right lung, and this is the collapsed left upper lobe, making a veil-like opacity on the left lung. The aortic knuckle here around it remain aerated because of the left lower lobe, and the left heart border is not seen very well. And this is the hilar, left hilar is pulled up with the collapsed left upper lobe. There is also a sign named juxtaphrenic peak sign. There is a tinting of the left hemidiaphragm due to the collapse of the left upper lobe, causing that the accessory fissure to be tracted upward. The lingula is part of the left upper lobe. You can see sometimes there is a consolidation only at the lingula, so the left heart border will not be seen very well. This is also a smaller one. And see, after treatment, after 8 weeks, the left heart border becomes so clear. There is a mimicker for the left heart border silhouette sign. You can see there is a rounded opacity here with calcification seen in its wall. If this patient should have previous myocardial infarction, and this is a left ventricular aneurysm. The lingular collapse will not happen alone because it is part of the left upper lobe. Now the left lower lobe, there is a consolidation here. See the left hemidiaphragm not seen very well. Again, this is the retrocardiac one. The left hemidiaphragm medial part not seen very well. This is signs of the left lateral left lower lobe collapse. There is a triangular density retrocardiac, and the medial part of the hemidiaphragm not seen, and the left hilar is pulled down, and the left pulmonary artery is not seen. All of these are important signs. See the triangular density here and the hilar. And again, this is the left normal left pulmonary artery, the little finger sign you cannot see here. Another example for the left lower lobe collapse, you can see the triangular density, the left hemi diaphragm medial part not seen, the hilla is seen depressed, and the left pulmonary artery not seen very well. This is a total collapse. You can see the abrupt cut off here in the left main bronchus due to the tumor, and there is a mediastinal shift ipsilateral to the left side. And you can see the right lung here is overinflated and crossed, even crossed the midline. This is a part of the right lung to compensate for the collapsed left lung. Here, a mimicker for left lower lobe collapse. You can see this is the aortic knuckle, and this is the descending aorta. This occurred due to aging. It is named unfolded aorta. Another mimicker here you can see named a hiatus hernia. This is a fusiform shaped. You can see airflow level here retrocardiac. You should train your eye for all of this. This is a summary for the causes of a collapsed lung or collapsed lobe. If the patient is middle-aged patient and smoker, you should suspect the bronchial carcinoma as a cause. If the patient is not smoker, you can suspect what is called endobronchial carcinoid tumor. Some rare times the cause could be endobronchial mets. If the patient collapsed after surgery, so the most common cause is a mucus plug or incorrect position of the endotracheal tube. We will discuss at the end of this lecture. If the patient is asthmatic, also mucus plug. If the patient is a child, you should suspect the inhaled foreign body. Again, this is summary for the lobar collapse, the signs of the lobar collapse. And in the next lecture, we will talk about the other causes of the opacification other than the lung pathologies. Okay, we will continue. Other causes for opacification you can see on the chest radiograph. We talked about the lung causes, and there is outside lung like pleura or the chest wall itself. First, you should differentiate between three the site of the abnormality, if it is intrapulmonary inside the lung, or if it is in the pleura, or it is in the chest wall itself. If it is in the intrapulmonary inside the lung itself, the margins would be very clear and well defined, and the interface between the pleura and the mass should be has acute angle. If it is inside the pleura, the interface should be obtuse angle. And the margins of this abnormality should not be very clear. There is part side has a clear margin, and the other side is not clear. And if it is extra pleural in the chest wall itself, like from the rib or from the skin, so it will be also has a characteristic appearance. Here is the image for intrapulmonary. There is acute angle here between the mass and the pleura. Here is the pleural abnormality. See, there is obtuse angle between the lung and the pleura. And this is extrapleural in the chest wall itself. The epicenter of the lesion should be in the chest wall itself, and indenting the lung, or has opacification on the lung, like here. And this is the pleural and this is the pulmonary. See the acute angle and obtuse angle. You should train your eye on it. The differential for the opacification due to pleura should be pleural thickening or pleural calcification or pleural effusion. Here is example for pleural thickening. You can see the pleura here is thick. Here also thick, and here in the lower part is thick. This is what is called asbestos-related pleural plaques. it should be has characteristic configuration like leaf like. It looks like that you draw by your pen on the lung tissue. There is multiple pleural plaques here. Sometimes if you see it is calcified plaques on the pleura, so it is mostly due to the asbestosis. Like here, there is calcification on the pleural plaques. Another entity you should train your eye about on it, there is a benign pleural thickening, or there is a pleural or there is apical mass on the lung apices. Here you can see this is a very small pleural thickening, irregular here outline, and here also this is due to aging, normally seen. You can see here this is the normal left lung apex. It is well inflated, but here you cannot see the right lung apex. It is a large dense mass. Sometimes you also can detect a rib destruction. This is called the Bancroft tumor. This is what we call the meniscus sign, a characteristic sign for the pleural effusion. You can see it here. In this image, this is a mimicker for the pleural effusion. Like we said in the beginning of the lecture about hyperinflated lungs, in the COPD patient, the diaphragm will be flat, and you can suspect a pleural effusion here, but this is due to the hyperexpansion. Here, what is called encysted pleural effusion. This is, has obtuse angle with the pleura, and the effusion is contained in the cyst. This mostly due to empyema. Another sign for the pleural effusion named phantom sign or pseudotumor, when there is a mild amount of pleural effusion contained inside a fissure. And here another example, you can see this is the stomach gas bubble, and this is the left hemidiaphragm. The distance between them should be less than 1 centimeter. Here there is a wide distance. This is mostly due to a subpulmonic effusion. Causes for the unilateral whiteout. The most common cause is that there is large pleural effusion or collapse of the entire lung or previous pneumonectomy. In previous pneumonectomy, you will see the surgical clips and posterior rib resections. The other rare entities. How you analyze the radiograph of a white unilateral whiteout lung. First, you should see the mediastinum. If the mediastinum is displaced to the opposite side of the effusion, and the trachea also displaced to the opposite side of the effusion, so this is mostly the cause is a large pleural effusion. If the mediastinum and the trachea is displaced ipsilateral to the same side of the white out lung, so the underlying cause should be an entire lung collapse. If the mediastinum and trachea is seen central, no displacement, so the cause should be combined between a collapse of the lung and pleural effusion. You should also see search for the any fractures or missing grips. If you saw the, like that, so the cause is no previous pneumonectomy. This is the pneumonectomy series. In the day one, there is air and effusion here. It should the air should be less on consequent days. If like here, after 5 weeks, there is a minimal amount of air. If the air is increasing, so you should suspect a bronchopleural fistula after the surgery. Another example for the whiteout, you can see here the mediastinum and trachea is pushed to the opposite side. Here, the mediastinum and trachea is displaced to the ipsilateral side, so the cause here should be underlying lung collapse, and the cause here should be a large pleural effusion. Here another example for the whiteout. but you can see the mediastinum and trachea is central, no displacement, so the cause is combined. There is a pleural effusion and also there is a lung collapse. Now we will talk about the second abnormality occurring in the lung, mass and the nodules, especially in the hidden areas. We will start by the solitary masses. First, you should know that your mimickers, they are your enemy. You should know them very well, not to confuse with a solitary mass. The most important one is the nipple, and there is also other things like healing rib fractures and the primary rib pathology or pleural blocks or incested pleural effusion like we saw the pseudotumor or phantom mass, or if there is a skin lesion, so you should know your mimickers. If you saw a solitary pulmonary nodule in the chest radiograph, the first step that you exclude your mimickers, the traps. The second thing, you should compare with the previous chest X-ray. If it is seen in the previous chest X-ray and unchanged, so it is mostly a benign cause, like a granuloma or a scar or something. If it is not seen on the previous image, so this is a new pathology, so you should give it more attention. Step three for the analysis, if there is no previous chest X-ray, so you should check this nodule, if it is benign or malignant. And the last thing, if it has malignant features, you should go for CT. This is the benign features for the solitary lung nodules. The size is small, less than 3 centimeters. And no change on subsequent images if it contains calcification, especially if a popcorn calcification or stable calcification like in hamartoma. If there is branching vessels around the mass, it could be arteriovenous malformation. And the stability of the size, the malignant features like the size is large, or growing in size in subsequent images, the margins are speculated or ill-defined, and there is radiating strands, or there is eccentric calcification. All of these are suspicious findings, so you should ask for a CT. And sometimes the mass has indeterminate finding, also it will be suspicious, especially if the patient is old age or has history of smoking or has family history. This is the situations that you should go for CT. If the lesion is increasing in size, if the lesion has classic malignant features or indeterminate features, you should go for CT. This example for the calcification, here there is a central calcification in benign nodules. If the calcification is eccentric, so it should be suspicious. This is example for the margin of the nodule or the mass. Here it has a irregular or ill-defined or speculated edges, so it is suspicious. Here again, the margin is irregular. There is here what is called a tail sign. There is a band between the mass and the pleura. Also suspicious. You can see here this right upper lobe mass. There is a cavitation inside. The cavitation inside should go for benign features like TB or aspergilloma. But sometimes there is tumors that can cavitate, like squamous cell carcinoma of the lung or osteosarcoma metastasis from the bone. Here is example for a popcorn calcification of the hamartoma. here there is a nodule or mass in the right lower lung zone. You can see here a band of vessels from the hilum till the mass. This is a characteristic for a pulmonary EVM, arteriovenous malformation. And if there is multiple masses or nodules, first also we should know our mimickers, like the nipples, the most important one, or as we said in the solitary also, if there is a skin lesions, or if there is a pleural pathology, or if there is rib pathology, so you should be aware for this. This is the nipple markers, the nipple marking. So, should train your eye on it. There is examples for multiple pulmonary nodules. Here they are multiple pulmonary nodules, and here is the mimickers. This is a pleural lesion, or this is the rib fracture and healing, or rib mass. The most common causes of multiple pulmonary nodules are listed here: inflammatory causes or neoplastic causes. There is some autoimmune disease like rheumatoid nodules, or vascular causes like multiple EVMs, or there is other causes like sarcoid or Langerhans. The features for multiple pulmonary nodules, if they are calcified, the differential should be between the TB and previous chicken pox or metastasis from osteogenic sarcoma. If they are miliary, that the size is less than 2 millimeters, and they are innumerable, and they are on all the lung zones, so the cause should be TB also, or miliary mets from thyroid cancer or sarcoidosis. If they cavitate, as we said, multiple abscesses or multiple metastasis from squamous cell carcinoma or vaginal granulomatosis. And be aware of small bolli, multiple small bolli, and the emphysematous lung disease or cystic bronchiectasis in the context of fibrosis disease. They are not cavitating nodules, so you should be aware of them. This is the most common causes of lung mets from the cancer. If they are different size and shape, here is the causes: kidney, head and neck, uterus. If they are, there is only one metastasis, mostly from the colon. If they are cannonball, they are very, very large in size, you should suspect the primary is in the kidney or in the colon. If they are cavitate, as we said, the miliary pattern, also we said the thyroid and kidneys. Calcified mets, primary from the bone, osteogenic sarcoma. This is some examples for the multiple pulmonary lesions. Here we can see there is multiple pulmonary nodules. Some of them cavitate. Here is cavity, here cavity, also here in the lower zones. If the patient, you should ask for the clinical context. If the patient is IV drug user, or if the patient has history of valve disease, and go for open heart surgery, you should suspect these are multiple abscesses from IV drug abuser or from endocarditis. Here is an example for dense metastasis. You can see all the nodules. Even if they are very small, you can see, because they are dense and calcified. So the cause should be primary osteogenic sarcoma. Here is an example for miliary nodules from the TB, innumerable and very small in size. Here is also miliary but calcified, so you should suspect the previous chicken pox or varicella pneumonia. Here is widespread. You should compare between both lung zones, the upper and the middle and lower lung zones. Here is another example for the miliary. See, it affects all the lung zones. An important entity here is named bronchoalveolar carcinoma. You should be aware of it, and that's why we ask for repeating chest X-ray after 8 weeks, 6 to 8 weeks after pneumonia, because bronchoalveolar carcinoma will not completely resolve with the antibiotics. It has multiple signs. It can come like a single solitary nodule, or like opacification, or multiple nodules. So be aware of it. This example from lung metastasis, multiple metastasis here. You can see one in the lower loop under the diaphragm. And this is the primary lung tumor. Another example here for lung to bone. This lateral rib is distracted. The primary could be here or here. So you should go for cross-sectional imaging and see the previous images. Here is miliary metastasis from breast or thyroid. Here is example for the cannonball mets from the renal cell carcinoma. And a very tricky one is behind the heart. There is a rounded mass here. Another one, also very tricky, under the diaphragm. It is here in the right lower loop or in the liver itself. Here we can see the right apical mass with causing the right hemidiaphragm is elevated because this mass invade the right phrenic nerve. Should be aware of this sequelae. This is another example for lung changes due to the tumors. This named lymphangitis carcinomatosis. You can see here reticular and reticulonodular changes reaching the pleural surface. You should look for any previous imaging and the clinical history of this patient. Another abnormality we can see on the lung, like cystic changes. First, we will talk about the bronchiectasis. There is multiple types. This one is tram lines, cylindrical like that, or this is ring or cystic changes, or tubular changes. Here we can see the tram line in the bases, and in the left side we can see the cystic changes of bronchiectasis. On the other image, we can see ring shadows, and also we can see tram line here. Should be aware of this bronchiectatic changes. Another example for the cavitation in the lung. This is a large cavity here and has a thick wall. You have wide differential. You should add with the clinical context to reach the diagnosis. If the patient is a smoker, you should suspect a cavitating lung cancer due to squamous cell carcinoma. If the patient has fever and cough, you should suspect abscess. If the patient is immunocompromised or has previous TB, you should suspect aspergilloma. And if the patient has multi-system affection, especially the upper respiratory tract signs, you should suspect vaginal granulomatosis. Another signs of the aspergilloma named finger in glove occur in the allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. You can see here mucus inside the bronchioles. Another sign for the allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis is named air crescent sign. There is aspergilloma in previously formed cavity. This is a fungus ball, and this is a good sign that there is air crescent inside this cavity. Another example for the finger in glove. Another cause for cavitation occurring in the lung, if it is in the upper loops specially, and there is multiple changes like cavitation and consolidation. Sometimes you can see enlarged lymph nodes in the previous images. You should go for a TB. Another mimicker for cystic lung changes, that if there is history of trauma, and you can see here a part of the colon in the left side of the chest, a herniated bowel, or if there is a phrenic nerve palsy like we saw in the right pancreas tumor before, the left hemidiaphragm is elevated and the colon is seen underneath it. This is also a mimicker. Here again for the phrenic nerve palsy. Now we will talk about the interstitial lung disease briefly. The most common ones that has a characteristic appearance on the chest radiograph, because this entity is entirely for the high resolution CT. First, you should know the difference between alveolar opacities and interstitial opacities. The alveolar opacities has lobar or segmental distribution. The interstitial opacities don't respect that. The alveolar opacities has hazy margin and like cotton wool appearance. The interstitial opacities are sharp. There is air bronchogram, like we said in the first in the beginning of the lecture, and the alveolar opacities rapidly changing over time. This is a diagram for the alveolar opacities. See the alveoli here is filled with fluid or pus or blood. Here is the interstitial opacities occur on the interstitium itself, and the alveoli appear normal. Here you can see on the right image, there is alveolar opacification, and this is the interstitial shadowing. You should train your eye about the difference between them. Again, here in the alveolar opacities, you can see there is air bronchogram, but here is the interstitial shadowing, reticulation, sometimes nodular changes. Again, here is alveolar shadowing, and this is the reticular shadowing. You can see the subpleural lines. This is the interstitial pulmonary edema, and this is the alveolar pulmonary edema. Both of them can occur in the context of heart failure, but you should know the pathogenesis of them. Here, another theory that will help you to identify the reticulations, that if you suspect reticulations in any part of the lung, you should zoom for it, and you should trace the vessels and throw it away. See here, all of these are vessels and branching vessels. So if you throw it away, you will not find any reticulations or lung changes. Another example for reticulations here. Here is a zoomed view. This is the normal lung, and this is the consolidation that we saw before, and air bronchogram inside, and this is a reticular and reticulonodular changes for the interstitial lung disease. But sometimes it is not so easy like that. There is an integrated part, some reticular changes, some alveolar changes in the same image. So also be aware of it. And here is a small diagram for the interstitial lung diseases, the reticular changes, nodular changes, high attenuation and low attenuation. Briefly, the most common causes here, reticular septal thickening or honeycombing, the nodular here in the high resolution CT, you should search for the distribution, if it is perilymphatic or centrilobular or randomly distributed, the high attenuation pattern, ground glass opacities or mosaic or crazy paving, and the low attenuation pattern mostly is cystic lung disease or bronchiectasis. Some examples for it. Here we can see reticular changes more in the lower lung zones and reaching the pleura. This is in the context of usual interstitial pneumonia. This is what we saw in the masses part. what we called lymphangitis carcinomatosis, part of the tumor spread. You can see here in this image, there is surgical clips in the axilla. And if you search for the previous imaging, the patient has previously breast cancer. And you can see here more on the right side, there is a reticular changes reaching the pleura. This is the cystic lung disease, cystic changes of the lung. Mostly the causes will be between the Langerhans cell histiocytosis and lymphangiomyomatosis. The lymphangiomyomatosis are purely cystic disease, and the cysts are evenly distributed and has similar appearance. In the Langerhans cell histiocytosis, the patient is a smoker, and it is nodular disease, and the nodules cavitate and form cystic changes, so it is not uniformly seen. You can see some nodular changes and some cystic changes, and the cysts will be bizarre shaped. This example for Langerhans cell histiocytosis, you can see there is some small cysts and some large cysts. There is scattered also nodules. You can see there is a faint right pneumothorax on the right side here. The other differential is the LAM, lymphangiomyomatosis. Other finding here is pleural effusion or obliteration of the CP angles. And if you tap this fluid, it will be chylous fluid. And you can see here there is surgical clips on the thoracic duct track. So all of this finding should go with lymphangiomyomatosis. It could happen also in the context of the tuberous sclerosis. There is a simple list for the causes of upper zone fibrosis and lower zone fibrosis. The most common causes is sarcoid and TB. The sarcoid has four stages. The stage one is only nodal disease, bilateral hilar lymph nodes and the right paratracheal like here. The stage two is nodal and interstitial or parenchymal lung disease like here. And this is also the stage two. You can see here reticulonodular changes on the lung, and here there is a left hilar opacification. Another example for sarcoid is eggshell calcification of the hilar lymph nodes. The other differential could be silicosis. Here is stage 4 or end stage sarcoidosis. You can see there is confluent fibrosis of the lungs, and there is architectural distortion. The other example for upper lobe fibrosis is the TB. TB also has primary and post-primary signs. The primary signs mostly are the hilar lymph nodes and the clinical signs. After that, the post-primary affection, there is cavitation or lung fibrosis. Here you can see cavitation and lung fibrosis. Here the miliary TB, the multiple innumerable small nodules. This is active disease. The patient should be isolated. There is a mimicker for upper lobe fibrosis named the radiation fibrosis if the patient has a mediastinal mass or thyroid mass and go for surgery, and after surgery did had a radiotherapy. There is changes occur in the lung due to the radiotherapy, but you should train your eye about these changes. It is so sharp and clear and bilaterally seen only on one area. This is other cause for upper lobe lung fibrosis, also due to ankylosing spondylitis. The fibrosis is seen on the both upper lobes here. Other causes are like progressive massive fibrosis. There is confluent changes seen in both upper lobes and conglomerate masses with distortion, architectural distortion, and volume loss. This occurs in the context of coal worker pneumoconiosis or silicosis. I think better to stop here, and we can continue next week. So we took the normal anatomy, and we took the first abnormality, the air. We didn't finish it yet. We will talk about the pneumothorax and the pneumomediastinum and the pneumoperitoneum next week. I hope this lecture could help you in your preparation for the 2B. I am sorry that it took a very long time. I've tried to make it more simple than that, but unfortunately I failed, I think. So
it was very interesting. Inshallah, next time we'll have a chance, inshallah, to continue next Sunday. And inshallah, thank you.